want to talk about motivation.
This is not just a game anymore.
Either we heal as a team.
Come on, join me. Let's do it. Ow! Everybody can do it. It's not difficult. Let's do it together, all right? Good.
Come to Terrence. Terrence will come to the molehill.
Not that kind of motivation for crying out loud. No, the boring, philosophical kind. And autism. And this book again. Hiya, I'm Mika, and I make videos about politics, philosophy, and life, all from an autistic perspective. So subscribe and hit the bell if that sounds like your cup of tea. So as you probably know, I was recently diagnosed as autistic. I probably will do a video about that in the future. My diagnosis journey. But I was thinking recently about some of the language used in a lot of the literature.
Unusual reactions. Restricted behavior. Abnormal approaches. Unreasonable.
So I got thinking, what's a reason? Well, alright, this isn't a question that I just thought up, rather something our bestest philosophers have been musing over for some time now. The question of reasons for motivation is something usually discussed in regards to ethics. So, for example, if I say, I believe that murder is wrong, and from that I support laws against murder, support punishments for murderers, and, you know, don't go out and do murders. But the question is, why do I hold that belief? Is it because we've just collectively decided that murder is wrong and that's a reasonable rule to which I can pose no objection? Or is it because I just don't want to live in a world where there's just murderers running around all over the place? That sounds scary. I would be scared. There are a few ethical debates which have to do with this question. There's the battle between reasons internalism and reasons externalism, which is basically the discussion of whether or not there can be external reasons for action, or do we always just do things because we have the feels to. And then there's that epic scrap between, what's it between? Consequentialist and deontological ethical theories. And that's about whether the morality of an action should all be about whether it fits in with the rules and regulations, the terms and conditions, the law and order, deontological. Or whether we should appeal to the actual or possible hypothetical consequences of an action. That's the consequentialism, obviously. Like, you might think that appealing to consequences when deciding on, say, a moral dilemma is, like, a given. But honestly, many fancy pants philosophers absolutely hate the idea. The favourite problem with consequentialism is what is known as the demandingness objection, which is, yeah, that, like, most people don't even realise the full consequences of each action, let alone are able to make meaningful calculations about that in real time. You can think of that saying, there is no ethical consumption within capitalism, or the scoring system on the good place. There are actually responses to the demandingness objection, but they're kind of convoluted and long, and I'm not going to talk about that here. But right, I reckon a huge amount of the disgust levelled at consequentialism and reasons internalism has to do with the fact that we humans are supposed to be special. We are supposed to be apart from the beasts, bequeathed with the likeness of God him very self. It shouldn't need to be appealing to no consequences, and we should, for heaven's sake, be able to put aside our feelings when deciding on matters of morality. Until up pops Davy Hume. Talk a lot about Hume on this channel. This isn't a Hume stan channel or anything, I just happen to have read a lot of Hume. Anyway, Hume were all, reason isn't ought to be the slave of the passions though. That was terrible. Not insensitive though. It's Scottish blood what makes this skin so translucent and ghost-like. Hume was an empiricist, meaning that he believed that we learn all we know. We were not, in fact, bequeathed without. He also had some thoughts about what motivates us to act or decide on actions. The Humean theory of motivation can be summarized as follows.
According to the Humean view, belief is insufficient for motivation, which always requires, in addition to belief, the presence of a desire or cognitive state. Moral motivation thus cannot arise from moral belief alone, but must depend as well on a pre-existing desire or other cognitive or intrinsically motivating state.
When he said that reason is and ought to be the slave of the passions, what he meant was that reason alone will never motivate action. Rather, we need the passion to. Yeah, no. Passion back then just meant like emotion, feels. For example, consider a smoker. They know it's going to shorten their life. They know it's probably going to be the thing which kills them. Makes them smell. Means you have to keep getting up and going outside these days anyway. It's expensive. You are funding evil. And you're probably getting it all over other people too. But people smoke because they feel like it. And if they do eventually give up, it will ultimately be because they feel like it. Hume said that people are motivated by seeking pleasure and avoiding pain, whatever that might mean for them. That this sounded way too much like hedonism for some of Hume's contemporaries. And it was a bit. However, some hedonists also believe that seeking pleasure and avoiding pain are the only things worth doing. I'll link to some sources on hedonism below if you care. I wonder why 18th century Christians were so anti-hedonism.
It's because pagan and Celtic religious traditions can be pretty hedonistic and to allow people to do what feels good directly threaten the European Christian worldview.
Hang on, the rationalists are shouting. You can't just throw shade at half of a debate that's been raging for centuries because something-something Christians. And yeah, alright. Let me get my receipts. Got him. Dr. Lisa Feldman Barrett is a distinguished professor of psychology who also works within the fields of cognitive neuroscience, psychophysiology, and affective neuroscience. You might remember me speaking about her work on facial expressions and emotions in my first ever video, club somewhere. Her work on emotions revealed that they are largely social constructs and that what really exists to our brains, rather than the full complexity of human emotion, it's affect, which is usually a mixture of what is known as valence and arousal, as illustrated here. Affect is the general sense of feeling that you experience throughout the day. It is not emotion, but a much simpler feeling with two features. The first is how pleasant or unpleasant you feel, which scientists call valence. The pleasantness of the sun on your skin, the deliciousness of your favorite food, and the discomfort of a stomach ache or a pinch are all examples of affective valence. The second feature of affect is how calm or agitated you feel, which is called arousal. The energized feeling of anticipating good news, the jittery feeling after drinking too much coffee, the fatigue after a long run, and the weariness from lack of sleep are examples of high and low arousal. Our brains use interoception and learned concepts to make sense of affect. Interoception is also one of the most important ingredients in what you experience as reality. If you didn't have interoception, the physical world would be meaningless noise to you. Consider this. Your interoceptive predictions, which produce your feelings of affect, determine what you care about in the moment, your affective niche. From the perspective of your brain, anything in your affective niche could potentially influence your body budget, and nothing else in the universe matters. Keeping us alive and keeping our bodily budgets in balance is basically all our brains really care about. And they do this by issuing predictions which drive behaviors based on our feelings of either pleasure or pain or high or low arousal. Now, I'm not going to argue that like we are our brains and nothing else, but it would be difficult to argue that it's not the thing which drives behaviours. as like literally it's our brains what send the signal to make movements. Brain says go. So yeah, I'm gonna go out there and say that old Hume is science confirmed. So sorry, Kant fans. I'm part joking, Kant fans. Please don't come for me. It would be against your imperative, that. Historical ethics jokes. I really, really am making that relatable content, aren't I? Okay, let's recap what we've learned so far. So we've looked at a couple of debates within moral philosophy about what motivates people to act morally or not. And then I suggested that recent neurological findings would likely side with the humane theory, which states very, very, very basically that people act in accordance with their feelings rather than their rational reasons. Feels over reals. Now listen to what Dr. Barrett says about what she terms the classical view of emotion. Our emotions, according to the classical view, are artifacts of evolution, having long ago been advantageous for survival and are now a fixed component of our biological nature. Emotions are thus thought to be a kind of brute reflex, very often at odds with our rationality. The primitive part of your brain wants you to tell your boss he's an idiot, but your deliberative side knows that doing so would get you fired, and so you restrain yourself. This kind of internal battle between emotion and reason is one of the great narratives of Western civilization. It helps define you as a human. Without rationality, you are merely an emotional beast. You see, Hume would say that we don't tell our annoying boss to get into the sea, not because our rational human big brains logically tell us that would be unreasonable, but because we just simply don't feel like being unemployed. We are avoiding the pain of destitution. Dr. Barrett goes on to describe how the shift in belief from creationism to evolution changed the way we thought about human nature, and how people desperately tried to rationalize their feelings that no, humans just are special. They are. She describes this mental gymnastics thusly. And your mind is a battleground, not of good and evil, righteousness and sin, but of rationality and emotionality, cortex over subcortex, inner versus outer forces, the thoughts in your brain versus the emotions in your body. You, with your animal brain wrapped in your rational cortex, are distinct from other animals in nature, not because you have a soul, but because you are the pinnacle of evolution, endowed with insight and reason. Now, our Lise, she practically tears this idea apart with her very own theory, known as the theory of constructed emotion. And she shows in this, you really should read this, it's good. What does she show? She shows that there is no battle between reasons and emotions. Hume was essentially right.
But what about autism though?
Right, so remember all that unreasonable language? I find that often, not always, but often, there is a focus on autistic people's behaviour. Take stimming or self-soothing, or take not giving eye contact, or take not being able to speak at certain times, or even using the only means you know to get out of a potentially painful situation. Briefly, for those of you who don't know, ABA stands for Applied Behaviour Analysis, which is a type of therapy which aims to change specific behaviours and usually takes place in quite an intensive one-on-one type setting. I have no experience myself of ABA, and what I do know I have garnered from other autistic YouTubers, so I've linked some videos down below if you're interested in hearing more about that. But from what I gather, it can range from being just like objectively cruel, like how on earth is this still a thing, to something which can be used by individuals as a useful tool. I'm not going to be discussing any ABA practices here, so please do go to the other videos for that. I do want to talk a little bit about the concept itself. Dr. Barrett talked about something called behaviorism in her book, saying this: "My cautionary tale begins in the early 20th century when scientists were searching in vain for the essences of anger, sadness, fear, and so on. Their repeated failures eventually led them to a creative solution. If we cannot measure emotions in the body and brain, they said, we'll measure only what happens before and after, the events that bring on an emotion and the physical reactions that result. Never mind what's happening inside that skull thing in the middle." Thus began the most notorious historical period in psychology called behaviorism. Emotions were redefined as mere behaviors for survival. Fighting, fleeing, feeding, and mating, collectively known as the four Fs. I just got that. Four Fs. The whole time I was like, mating's not an F. Psychologists often recount stories of behaviorism in the same chilling tones as a ghost story around a campfire. It declared that thoughts, feelings, and the rest of the mind were unimportant to behavior or might not even exist. During this dark age of emotion research, which lasted for several decades, nothing worthwhile was discovered on human emotion. Ultimately, most scientists rejected behaviorism because it ignores a basic fact that each of us has a mind, and in every waking moment of life, we have thoughts and feelings and perceptions. These experiences and their relation to behavior must be explained in scientific terms. Okay, so behaviorism is a systematic approach to understanding the behavior of humans and other animals. The application of radical behaviorism known as... It ignores our affect, which is impossible for any human brain to do. So, my hypothesis. I posit that rather than it being the way that autistic people act or behave that's different, it is rather the things which we find painful and pleasurable. And that, in fact, we are behaving perfectly in line with current accepted understandings of human behavior and how it works. We avoid or make efforts to avoid things which cause us pain. Be it social pain, bright lights, loud noises, uncomfortable clothes or situations. It's not an exhaustive list, by the way. And we seek pleasure, think special interests, repetitive behavior, self-soothing or stimming for stimming's sake. So rather than our behavior and reaction, it's the things which give us pleasure and pain which is different. Speaking of light aversion, I'm sorry that the light is so changeable today. Pretty stormy looking out there, but this is the first day in a while that the wind has not been beating directly against the window, so I have to film. Some things which are really painful for autistic people, like neurotypical people, wouldn't even notice is occurring. And as anybody who lives with chronic pain will tell you, as pain is invisible, it's often really hard to get people to fully sympathize with you. Like, I'm pretty sure if most people saw like someone running, screaming down the street away from an attacker who wanted to hurt them, they wouldn't be like, eh, what an unreasonable and abnormal reaction. Like, that person is afraid of being put into a lot of pain and they are survival of the fittest thing it out of there. Yet, if somebody's pain is, say, due to a sensory disorder and they run away screaming, then this is seen as unusual, because the things that cause that person's pain are not obviously detectable to most people, as an attacker chasing somebody down the road would be. It is certainly unusual to experience pain from, for example, certain noises, but reacting against things which cause you pain isn't. The fact that I'm arguing that autistic behaviour might be perfectly in line with what we term as normal human behaviour, that does not mean that I am trivialising autistic need. Autism in many cases certainly is a disability because it's so unusual to experience pain from the kinds of things which cause autistic pain, meaning that our societies are simply not designed with us in mind, and that therefore is disabling. I've linked to Les Exploitable's video on the social model of disability in capitalism below. But also, as I pointed out on Twitter recently, there are certain aspects of my autism which cause me pain, and I think would do no matter what society did. Societal changes would do an awful, incalculable lot to ease autistic suffering though, and that's why it's such a key aim for advocates, rightly so. So, to recap, we've discovered the unscientific and ideological foundations of ABA, as well as how wrong are the assumptions that autistic behaviour is
unreasonable.
I've discussed how flawed this thinking is, while taking from historical philosophical theories as well as modern neurological understandings. And so I conclude that maybe, just maybe, we should be putting less focus on autistic people's behaviour and more focus on autistic people's experience. Thank you for watching this video. If you liked it, please like it. Subscribe and hit the bell if you haven't already, and do please share this. Kind of really need the promo help. I'm still just really, really rubbish at the whole sell yourself bit. Follow me on Twitter for rants and political hot takes, and Instagram for photos of my life and travels. And I will see you next time.